بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وعلى آله وصحبه ومن اهتدى بهداه أما بعد. Tonight we continue with the explanation of Kitab Al-Tawheed taken from Sahih Al-Bukhari or Al-Jami' Al-Sahih, which is its correct name. And last week we stopped at the hadith of Hudhayfa ibn al-Yaman radiyallahu ta'ala anhu, the hadith where he said that whenever the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam went to bed, he used to say, Allahumma bismika ahya wa amut. And when he woke up in the mornings, he would say, Alhamdulillah alladhi ahyana ba'dama amatana wa ilayhi an-nushur. So in this hadith, Hudhayfa radiyallahu ta'ala anhu, he says when the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam went to bed, and this means whenever he went to sleep after being out during the day. Whenever he went to sleep after being out during the day, he would say, Allahumma bismika ahya wa amut. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam would go to sleep remembering the name of Allah azza wa jal, and he will acknowledge that he remembers Allah's name while he is living, alive, and with his heart being content with that. So when you say Allahumma bismika ahya wa amut, this means that you remember Allah azza wa jal while you are alive, and with your heart being content with that, since there is no comfort or rest for the human except by mentioning Allah's name. There is no comfort or rest except by mentioning and remembering Allah Azza wa Jal. And this statement, it means my life can never be beneficial except by mentioning your name, Ya Allah. My life can never be beneficial except by mentioning Allah's name. And by remembering your name, O Allah, I die. So I remember your name when I am alive, and I remember your name at the time of death, when I die. Interceding with Allah Azza wa Jal through His names, that He protects you in all your affairs. He says, and when he woke up in the mornings, he used to say, Alhamdulillah alladhi ahyana ba'dama amatana wa ilayhi an-nushur. The reason why the Prophet ﷺ used to make this dua when he wakes up is because sleep, as we've mentioned, is a form of death. Sleep is a form of death. And when you are awake, you are alive. And that is a blessing from Allah Azza wa Jal, because the bodies rest and the mind rests at the time of sleep. And the fact that a person may sleep and their soul does not return to their body. But if the soul returns to the body after sleep, then the strength is returned to the body, and for that reason Allah Azza wa Jal is thanked. And that's why the Prophet ﷺ used to thank Allah for allowing him to wake up, that he is given another opportunity to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And an-nushur, as mentioned in the hadith, wa ilayhi an-nushur, the meaning of nushur here is resurrection. Wa ilayhi an-nushur means, and to Allah is the resurrection after the major death. Because we know after we all die, we will all be resurrected and brought forward to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So this hadith is confirming and reminding us that we will all return to Allah azza wa jal and be resurrected out of our graves, and that He will reward us according to our deeds. And this hadith, like the previous hadith, Imam Al-Bukhari rahimahullah has used it because it consists of mentioning the name of Allah Azza wa Jal, and that we intercede through Allah's names. Then Imam Al-Bukhari rahimahullah moves on with the next hadith in this chapter, the hadith of Abu Dharr radiyallahu ta'ala anhu, where he said, عن أبي ذر قال كان النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم إذا أخذ مضجعه من الليل قال باسمك نموت ونحيا فإذا استيقظ قال الحمد لله الذي أحيانا بعدما أماتنا وإليه النشور. This hadith is similar to the previous hadith, and the one who narrated this hadith is Abu Dharr al-Ghaffari radiyallahu ta'ala anhu. And there is a difference of an opinion regarding his name, because he was mainly known by his kunya, Abu Dharr radiyallahu ta'ala anhu. And Al-Hafidh Ibn Hajar rahimahullah, he preferred the opinion that his name was Jundub ibn Junada radiyallahu ta'ala anhu, the name of Abu Dharr, as preferred by Ibn Hajar rahimahullah, was Jundub ibn Junada. And he was from the early Sahaba. Jundub ibn Junada radiyallahu ta'ala anhu, or Abu Dharr, he was from the early Sahaba to embrace Islam. And his hijrah was delayed, even though he was from the early Muslims. His hijrah was delayed because he went to his tribe. After becoming a Muslim, he lived amongst his tribe. And for that reason, he missed out on the first battles with the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, even though he was a Muslim. He didn't participate in the early battles because he lived with his tribe. And Abu Dharr radiallahu ta'ala anhu was known for his zuhd, his disassociation from the dunya, for he had no concern for the dunya whatsoever. And he passed away the year 32 Hijri. And this hadith does not have any extra explanation from the previous ahadith, because it is similar to the previous ahadith. Then Imam Al-Bukhari rahimahullah mentions the next hadith, the hadith of Ibn Abbas radiyallahu ta'ala anhuma, where he said, عن ابن عباس radiyallahu anhuma قال قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم لو أن أحدكم إذا أراد أن يأتي أهله فقال بسم الله اللهم جنبنا الشيطان وجنب الشيطان ما رزقتنا فإنه إن يقدر بينهما ولد في ذلك لم يضره شيطان أبدا. This hadith of Ibn Abbas radiallahu ta'ala anhu, that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, if any one of you, when intending to have sexual relations with his wife, says, Bismillah, Allahumma jannibna shaytan wa jannib shaytan ma razaqtana, shaytan would never harm that child if it is decreed for them to have one. Shaytan will never harm that child if it is decreed for them to have one. But this hadith, my brothers and sisters, is another dua using Allah's name, because it begins with Bismillah. And when the Prophet ﷺ taught us to say this dua before the husband and wife are intimate, the meaning of Bismillah in this hadith here is that I perform this remembering the name of Allah Azza wa Jal, worshipping my Lord with this remembrance and seeking His blessing. And seeking His blessing. And that is why it is crucial that the Muslim and the Muslim family, they learn these ad'iyah and this dua in particular, in order for their offspring, if Allah grants them that, to be protected from the shayateen. And that is why this dua is legislated between a husband and a wife at the time of intimacy. Allahumma jannibna shaytan. So the hadith or the dua, after the person says Bismillah, they say Allahumma jannibna shaytan, which means keep us away from the shaitan. Keep us away from the shaitan and do not allow him to join us during this act. And do not allow him to join us during this act and do not allow him to be present with us. So you can see and understand the importance of this dua, because it closes the door of shaitan being able to affect a husband and wife during this time. وَجَنِّبِ الشَّيْطَانِ مَا رَزَقْتَنَا. Not only are you asking Allah to keep the shaitan away from you and your wife, or you and your husband during this act, but you are also asking Allah to protect your offspring, your child, if it is decreed for you to have one, for it to be protected from the shaitan also. And there must be iman and firm belief in what the Prophet ﷺ said in order to achieve this. Meaning you must make these type of ad'iyah with yaqeen, certainty that Allah is the protector. And the reason why Imam al-Bukhari put this hadith here is to mention that Allah Azza wa Jal's name is to be mentioned when the husband approaches his wife and seeking refuge with Allah from shaitan. Then we move on to the next hadith, the hadith of Adi ibn Hatim radiyallahu ta'ala anhu, where Imam al-Bukhari rahimahullah said, عن Adi ibn Hatim radiyallahu ta'ala anhu قال, سألت النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم قلت أرسل كلابي المعلمة قال إذا أرسلت كلابك المعلمة وذكرت اسم الله فامسك فأمسكنا فكل وإذا رميت بالمعراض فخرق فكل. Adi ibn Hatim radiyallahu ta'ala anhu said, I asked the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and I said to him, I send off for hunting my trained hunting dogs. What is your verdict regarding the game that they hunt, regarding the animals that my dogs catch? So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said to him, if you send off your trained hunting dogs and mention the name of Allah, that's the part of the hadith Imam al-Bukhari is intending. Once again, we are using the names of Allah Azza wa Jal. And you mention the name of Allah, then if they catch some game, eat from it. And if you hit the game with a mi'rad, which is a hunting tool like an axe that they used to throw or something similar, and it wounds the animal, you can eat it. For this is the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And the companion that's asking this question is Adi ibn Hatim radiyallahu ta'ala anhu, and his kunya was Abu Tarif Al-Jawad ibn al-Jawad radiyallahu ta'ala anhu. He came to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in the 9th year of Hijrah, meaning he was from the later Sahaba to embrace Islam. And the reason why he came and embraced Islam was due to a letter his sister wrote him. His sister wrote him a letter and she called him to Islam, and then he answered and he embraced Islam. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam became very happy when he became a Muslim, because Adi ibn Hatim radiyallahu anhu had a high status with his people. He was in a high position with his tribe. And as we know, it was from the wisdom of the Prophet ﷺ that he used to put a great effort in trying to win the chiefs of the tribes to Islam. Because when you win the chief, it is much easier to win the people in that tribe also. So the Prophet ﷺ became happy when Adi ibn Hatim radiyallahu anhu became a Muslim. And it is narrated that Adi ibn Hatim radiyallahu anhu, he said, no salah has ever entered except that I was looking forward to it. Subhanallah, it's a simple statement, but it's heavy. Yani, who can really say that today? He said, no prayer entered in its time except that I was looking forward to it. And he passed away in Kufa in the year 68 Hijri. And it was said he was 120 years old when he passed away, radiyallahu ta'ala anhu. And this hadith, my brothers and sisters, indicates to another form of worship, which is mentioning Allah's name when hunting and when sending hunting dogs. And it's important, especially brothers that take it as a hobby to go hunting and hunt with dogs, as we know some brothers do, it's important that you know and you learn the fiqh of the sport and what is required for you as a Muslim. So in order for a dog to be able to hunt for you, it has to be trained. Shar'an, it has to be trained. And the hunting dog, which is trained, means it obeys its owner. That's the definition of a trained dog. It obeys its owner, meaning if you send it, it goes, and if you prevent it, it stops. And a hunting dog in Islam is a dog that does not hunt for itself, it hunts for its owner, meaning its job is to catch, and it does not eat from the game that it catches. If the dog eats from the game, it means it hunted for itself and not for its owner, and you cannot eat from the meat if the dog has hunted for itself and eaten from the meat. Yes, it can bite and dig its jaws and whatever else, but when the owner tells it to come, bring the game and to let go and whatever else, it obeys. That's the trained dog in Islam that is permissible to use for hunting. And we understand from the hadith that if the person does not mention the name of Allah when releasing the dog or throwing the mi'rad, then the meat does not become halal. For the mentioning of Allah Azza wa Jal's name is crucial when using a hunting animal. Then we have the hadith of Aisha radiyallahu ta'ala anha, where Imam al-Bukhari rahimahullah said, عن عائشة قالت قالوا يا رسول الله إن هنا أقواما حديثا عهدهم بشرك يأتون بلحمان لا ندري يذكرون اسم الله عليها أم لا قال أذكروا أنتم اسم الله وكلوا. So Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha, in this hadith, she says that the people said to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, O Allah's Messenger, here are people who have recently embraced Islam and they bring us meat. And we do not know whether they have mentioned Allah's name while slaughtering the animals or not. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, you mention Allah's name and eat. So this hadith, to get a general understanding, the Sahaba went to ask the Prophet ﷺ. They said, Ya Rasulullah, this group of people here are new to Islam, meaning they might not know all the rules that are required in the religion yet, because they're still new. But they bring meat to us. We do not know if they mentioned Allah's name at the time of slaughter or not. What should we do? So the Prophet ﷺ said to them, use mention Allah's name and eat. He didn't tell them leave the food. He told them use mention Allah's name and eat. And in this hadith, there is proof that mentioning the name of Allah on the animal is a condition in order for it to be halal. And if the one making the sacrifice appears to be Muslim, we pay no attention as to whether he may or may not have mentioned the name of Allah. And this statement is by the Sharikh, the explainer of the book, the great scholar Abdullah Al-Ghunayman Hafidhahullah. And this is a crucial point and a principle for us, because he said, if the one making the sacrifice appears to be a Muslim, we pay no attention to whether he may or may not have mentioned the name of Allah. This teaches us what? To trust your fellow Muslim. And this is very important. Why? Because today it is sad, but it's a reality, that certain sects or groups, they have gone what you might call extreme regarding the slaughtering and the food that is provided by Muslims. Yes, we must be cautious. We do not doubt that. We must make sure that the food we eat is halal. We do not doubt that. But our caution should never lead us to questioning and doubting a fellow Muslim who provides us with food. And this hadith is from the greatest dalil for that. The Prophet ﷺ did not tell the Sahaba, go ask them if they mentioned Allah's name. Go ask them how they slaughtered their meat. Go ask them what they done. Prophet ﷺ did not tell them to do that. Khalas, they're Muslims, trust them. If you have that little bit of doubt, say Bismillah yourself and eat. And that's a good principle for us, that we do not question or doubt the meat of the fellow Muslim if there is no reason to doubt it or question it. You take your Muslim brother and sister at face value. And the asl is that the Muslim is trustworthy unless there is dalil to remove him out of that category. Some people have done the acts. To them, everyone is dishonest until you can prove his honesty. Subhanallah. What kind of sharia is this? That's incorrect. In Islam, every Muslim is trustworthy until there is dalil that you take him out of that trustworthiness. And that's how Islam is understood. So rather, the Prophet ﷺ commanded them to mention the name of Allah when they eat, and that makes the food more pure for them. And this hadith also indicates to another form of worship, which is mentioning Allah's name at the beginning of slaughter. Because when you sacrifice an animal, you must mention Allah Azza wa Jalla's name at the time of slaughter. For this hadith and the previous ahadith, Imam al-Bukhari is bringing them so that we learn that Allah's names are not a creation. His names and His attributes are not a creation, and that's why we seek refuge with Allah through His names and through His attributes, and we call Him through His names and through His attributes, because nothing that comes from Allah Azza wa Jal, from His names or His attributes, are created. Inshallah, next week we will continue with the hadith of Anas radiyallahu ta'ala anhu. Wallahu a'lam wa sallallahu wa sallam wa barak ala nabiyyina Muhammad wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam.
Al-Bayan Radio, the voice of Ahl Sunnati wal Jama'ah.